Okay, and here we have 1 Corinthians 6, and the main issue, the main verse is part of verse 9, okay? And that's the one most people will cite, okay? See, those who indulge in sexual sin, or who worship idols, or commit adultery, or are male prostitutes, or practice homosexuality, okay? Or thieves, or greedy people, or drunkards, or are abusive, or cheap people, none of these will inherit the kingdom of God. That's the verse that's mostly usually cited. Thank you so much. And wait, I jumped one. I'm going to start with Leviticus. Okay, here we go. So let's start with Leviticus, and that's where a lot of people start. And Leviticus, of course, is way back in the Old Testament, right? And the main verse that is cited is 22. Do not practice homosexuality, having sex with another man as a woman. It is a detestable sin. It's pretty clear. Well, a lot of equivocation there, okay? It seems pretty clear, but let's try to get a better understanding of it by reading the verses surrounding it. What's the sentiment that leads to it? So let's look at starting in chapter 18. And then the Lord said to Moses, give the following instructions to the people of Israel. Okay? God's talking to Moses. Man, you know, God talked to people audibly a lot back then, okay? It's before before the Bible was complete, so people could read. And it says, I am the Lord your God, so do not act like the people of Egypt where you used to live, or the people of Canaan where I'm taking you. You must not imitate their way of life. You must obey all my regulations and be careful to obey my decrees, for I am the Lord your God. If you obey my decrees and my regulations, you will find life through them. I am the Lord. Okay? So the whole purpose for this whole thing is God is saying, this is how you should be living your life. Don't live it like where you were and where you're going. Okay? And the first thing he brings up, first thing God brings this up, okay? God is bringing this up. He says, quote, you must never have sexual relations with a close relative, for I am the Lord. Okay? Not with a close relative. And yes, there is a gap between 6 and 22, and you know what? That gap is spent with God talking about all the various relatives you should not be messing with. It's a long list. But then after concluding that long list, then he goes on, do not practice homosexuality. It's pretty clear what he has to say. There's no mention there about prostitution. There's no mention there about rape. There's no mention there about abuse or anything like that. But you know what? A lot of that was happening back then. So when you think about it in context, you can say, yeah, well, you know, it's not mentioned there. But you know what? In context, a lot of that was going on back then. Okay? So you can make a case for that, and I can see that, okay? I can see that, being in all fairness, you can see that. But then we've got to compare scripture with scripture, okay, as well as looking at it in context, so which brings us to Corinthians, where we already read it, and here Paul is writing to the Corinthian church, and the Corinthian church is in Corinth. Corinth was a major commercial center. That means a bunch of sailors used to go there all the time. So it was really a lot of debauchery going on in Corinth, okay? A lot of money going on in Corinth. So there was a lot of corruption in Corinth and a lot of virtuous stuff happening in town, right? It was like the Barbary Coast. And Paul is addressing that as he writes to the Corinthian church, because they're adopting a lot of what's going on around them in what they do, because you know money talks, right? So basically Paul is saying, hey, you know, all that stuff that's going on around you, don't do that. And if you read the stuff that's before, don't you realize that those who do wrong will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't fool yourselves. Those who indulge in sexual sin, and we did all that, okay? So you see that the prelude to it is that don't do that stuff. It says if you want to follow God's ways, you don't do that kind of stuff. And then he goes into a list of all these different things that if you do it, it's not, God doesn't think that's cool, right? And it follows up. But some of you were once like that. We were all sort of like that, at least in part, okay? We were all sort of like that. And when you were cleansed, and you were made holy, he says, man, if you're with me, God is saying, if you're with me, you know, yeah, you used to do those things, but you don't do those anymore. You don't do them anymore. You were made right by God by calling on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. And that is the context of this verse, okay? And does it kind of fit with the Leviticus, the way that we originally read it? Yeah, kind of. Yeah, it does. God said, don't do that, okay? That is not what I think is best for you. It's not just, I'm not letting you do stuff. It's not good for you to do that. It's like you're teaching your kid, don't do that. And it's not because you want to just keep them from having a good time. You know that it's not good for them not to do that. You know, it's good for them to refrain from that kind of activity because of whatever reason. And the way it's written here, of course, is that homosexuality is a sin, just like so many other things that you can do. Okay, you know, promiscuous heterosexual sex outside of marriage, that would fall on the same list. Sex outside of marriage in general falls out of that list. I mean, you know, I just want to talk about marriage sometime too. But so all these different things. So homosexuality is a sin, yes. But is it an unforgivable sin? Is it like set apart beyond all? No, it's a sin. And any sin separates you from God. Any sin. Okay? And this makes it pretty clear here. And this is in Romans, this is probably where the subject of homosexuality is written the most clearly. In fact, that's what David Jeremiah said. He says, You're not gonna find the treatment of the subject of homosexuality and what God thinks of it any clearer than you're gonna see in Romans. Okay? And so I've only got 15 minutes, so I'm gonna have to hurry, okay? So it says here that in Romans, the main verse is so God abandoned them to do whatever shameful things their hearts desired. As a result, they did vile and degrading things to each other's bodies. They traded the truth about God for a lie, so they worshiped and served the things God created instead of the Creator himself, who is worthy of eternal praise. Amen. Actually, the main verse is 26. That is why God abandoned them to their shameful desires. Even the women turned against the natural way to have sex and instead indulged in sex with each other. And the men, instead of having normal sexual relations with women, burned with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men. As a result of this sin, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserved. So it's really clear, okay? And the way I've heard this kind of rationalized is that, well, hey, about the natural and the normal, okay? It says, well, you know, if what's natural for me is to have sex with another guy, if I'm a guy, and I am, then that's natural for me, okay? So God wants me to do what's natural for me. So natural for me to do this, and I do that, and natural for you to do that, and you do that. But if you read this and read what's around it, it's hard to make that argument. Even though you know you can make that argument. It's a stretch. It's a stretch. Okay. And the context of this is Rome. All kind of orgies and toga parties going on in Rome, right? A lot of stuff going on in Rome, and abandoned or gave them over in the New American Standard. Translation, instead of abandoned, it's God gave them over. In other words, God let you do what you wanted to do. So if you want to do that, you know, if you're going to abandon me, and if you're going to choose to do this, and I told you not to, go ahead and do it. I'm going to let you do it. It's really the same philosophy when it comes to hell, okay? Hell is separation from God. And God is saying, you know what, you want to live your life away from me? You got it, man. You're going to go down to the hot spot, and you're going to be away from me. You do whatever you want down there, okay? And you'll be away from me. That's what hell is. God cries as he lets you go down there. He doesn't want you to go down there. Not you, you know, anybody. But other people. But it's the same kind of thing, you know. At a certain point, you know, God will just let you do what you want to do. Okay, we don't have time to look at the New American Standard, okay? But anyway, my conclusion from studying Scripture back in the 90s was that Scripture teaches that homosexual practice is sin. Okay? That's my conclusion that I reached at that time, way back then. And you know what? I am not the only one who's reached that conclusion. I can't see it very well here, but all these pastors and authors and Christian leaders in the United States have reached that same conclusion. My conclusion is not that, it's really pretty much the conclusion of many, 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 if not the mainstream of Christianity in the United States. And you might recognize some of these people. That's Francis Chan right here. And that's Josh McDowell. Those of you older folks, you probably remember Josh McDowell, Right and Wrong, okay? And his son is Sean McDowell, has same feelings, conclusion. Billy Graham, his son Franklin, same conclusion. You know, there's tons of John Piper right here. There's a lot of people here that are just, these are some of the really leaders of Christendom today, okay? And they have the same conclusion that I have regarding this topic. So let's go to the scientific thing now. I only got a few minutes to do that. So the scientific thing, born this way, Lady Gaga certainly thinks it's true, that you're born this way. And if you believe people are born gay and they can't help but be gay, would it change the way you feel about them? It would way change the way I feel about it. Because you know what, my God would not make people a certain way that they can't change, that they can't have any input into to change their outcome, and then whack them and send them to hell. My God is a loving and merciful God. I wouldn't do that, okay? And that's the main reason why I did my study. My God wouldn't do that. He wouldn't do that. So let me give you some reasons why science, reasons based in science, some tighter than others, why it can't be. Okay. First are epidemics. And epidemics means that if something was in the gene pool, if something was in the genetics that was expressed at a regular interval. Then what would happen is that the expression of homosexuality would be fairly uniform. Okay, it would be fairly uniform. But epidemics have occurred, like Romans, big spike, Greece, and now probably too there'd be a spike. Okay, that's sort of an argument. I don't think that's the strongest of arguments. The gene pool, though, is a very logical argument. Okay, but just by their very nature, homosexuals, they don't procreate. Just by what they do, they're not going to breed and make more of themselves. So therefore, if there is truly a gay gene, since they don't have kids, it would eventually dissipate. So the number of homosexuals over history should go down, okay? Since they're not making new ones, since they're not, they're not having new kids, right? Okay, just like yeah, okay, I think it's easy to see that, okay? It's easy to see that. That the numbers should go down. Identical twins. Identical twins have the same DNA. That's the nature of identical twins. They're made from the same sperm and egg and split around D6 after fertilization. If you're an identical twin, if you have hemophilia, your identical twin is going to happen. It's genetically determined. If you have color blindness, sickle cell anemia, your identical twin will happen because your DNA is the same. Okay? But when it comes to people that were separated at birth, identical twins that were separated at birth, the incidence of both of them being homosexual is about 60% from what I remember hearing. This is back in the 90s when I remember hearing this. I've not forgotten that number. And people may say, well, 60%, it's genetic, right? And you know what? There's got to be some level of connection there, but it's not 100% because it's not 100% like it is here. So really, rather than being proof that it is genetic, it's actually proof that it's not 100% genetically determined, because it's not. It's not, okay? Because if it was 100%, like with these things, it would be 100% going forward, okay? The gay gene, there ain't no such thing. I defy anybody to tell me that they found that there's a gay gene. There is no such thing, okay? Gay researchers have tried and tried and tried to find it. No such thing, okay? Anatomy, this is something I added in. I teach anatomy. And if you think about it, guys and gals, perfect fit, okay? Perfect fit. The vagina of the female, it's made to receive. It's self-lubricating. And when it comes to gay men, at least, when we talk about what happens over there, that part of the body is not meant for receiving. It's meant for letting things out, right? So it's not the same, and it's not a clean system. And of course, with male and female, we're talking about procreation. It works great. We're all here. I'm going to have to try to start wrapping up. The 10% thing is from a McKinsey study in the 40s. Widely discredited as being bad science, bad study. Nobody really cites that as being really true anymore. The true incidence of homosexuality in the population is under 5%. Some have said 1, 2, 3%. So it's there. It's not there. It's definitely there. We know it's there. But it's not 10. It's never been 10. And it's a number that basically Kinsey pulled out of the air. Okay. But there are traits that